Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Do solemnly swear.
And I will support, I guess we're supposed to do this too.
And I will support the Constitution. Of the United States. And the Constitution of the State of Iowa. And that I will faithfully and impartially. To the best of my ability. Discharge all duties of the position. Of a reserve officer in the city. Of Independence. As now and hereafter required by law. Fantastic. I'll let you sign all those for you.
Just stay on and smile.
I'm good. Taking glasses off.
Yeah.
me at the same time.
Of course.
Hand over. Okay.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, the same. Motion carried. Thank you. Next, I need a motion to approve the claims for payment.
So moved.
Motion by Kurtz.
Second.
Second by Hill.
I have a question.
Okay.
On Taylor Construction, $188,533. Is that the final payment?
No, that is not the final payment. That's the progress payment. There's still retainage, and there is a change order that you're going to address here shortly.
How much is the final payment, do you know, or how?
I don't have that.
Thanks.
It would be in the neighborhood of, if I'm not mistaken, in the $40,000 or $50,000 range. I mean, it's substantial. This is just the progress payment, the latest progress payment.
Any other questions? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, the same. Next on the agenda is, we have Tyler Construction, and whoever your other person was with you come forward. We want to have them present first before you make the motion.
Yes, there was a question, I think Monica was here from representing AECOM, and the discussion was.
Actually, the traffic control subcontractor is on his way, but not here yet.
I'm here.
So we would ask, oh.
I'm here.
Oh, okay. Sorry, I didn't see you. Okay. So then I'll ask Taylor and Vaughn to come up and discuss.
I'm back up, so.
Okay.
And Monica, I apologize. I meant WHK, it's not AECOM.
That's all right. This was for the change order for the additional signage that we put in after the project had started, some additional detours around town, and then specifically the Second Street detour and the no parking signs. So I know you had questions for concerning the cost of it.
Yes, specific questions.
I think the one was the $4,200 for the Leith and Bethel sign. I think that was the question, if I remember right.
It was that, and then there was a question about the cost per sign for the no parking signs. Appeared to be a large number.
And as I, when we quoted the, our financials kind of go through Taylor. They ask us for a price. We submit a price to Taylor, which I believe at the time was just for the traffic control, which we kind of lumped together, the detour signage. And then there's a separate line item for just the traffic control, or the no parking, I'm sorry.
That was an additional add-on. There was no parking in the original contract.
Correct. Okay. Yeah, because I guess all of it. So this is our price to Taylor.
If I can make copies of this one.
So the no parking signs on Second is not part of the original thing, that was additional cost?
Correct.
The signage on Second Street Northeast was not a part of the original contract.
What
did
that?
In my discussion with WHKS before the project was let, and at the pre-construction meeting, the discussion was because it was local traffic that would be taking that, we all assumed the local traffic would find their way around and there wouldn't be a need for any additional signage on Second Street or the no parking signs. The only detour that was needed was the one mandated by the state, which was to take Ned from Bethel out to and around on County Home Road.
There was no in-town detouring signs at all?
No.
I guess I just don't understand that. It doesn't make sense. It's...
I understand the company charging for it because he did it, but I think that should have been the contract because he should have foreseen the traffic would have been handled. That being a construction site.
And it wasn't local traffic, it was construction traffic and concrete trucks all day long and gravel trucks all day long.
Yeah, daily commuters that are going to jobs on the other side of town.
Yeah.
From out of town through that part of town. I mean, that was my understanding from the start before any agreed construction happened.
I guess that's something we'll have to bear in mind on our next project.
Technically, we approved the contract.
But did you approve this?
Oh, it wasn't in there.
Right.
But we expect the engineer to be able to do that for us.
When you approve a contract, you expect it all to be there, right?
Absolutely.
What if it was $100,000, what would you say then?
How many times have we told about the engineer doing so?
I have a question on the motion. It says for $5,610 and this invoice is $5,100.
The invoice that you're looking at, if I'm not mistaken, is the subcontractor to the contractor.
There's probably a 10% for Taylor probably tacked on that. I think that's part of the DOT specification.
This was your original estimate?
No, that was our bid.
That's your original bid, but it was not the actual change order.
That's a different one.
That was the actual. You should have the numbers for the change order in the documents that you received earlier.
The one that I passed is the quote.
That was the original quote, which was in part of the contract, which really isn't part of the discussion right now. It's the change order portion, the additional signage you received information before.
How many signs were involved in this? Much money?
And that was for approximately 22 signs and a couple of barricades.
Those signs, a lot of those no parking signs are reusable, right?
Most of them are, yeah. Probably half.
What about the other ones?
They're all detour signs. Most of the signs we use are reused for our projects.
So we didn't.
There were a couple customs ones that said First Street East.
Right. That I can understand. Mm-hmm. This is just rent. You're keeping the signs, right?
Well, yeah. That's our
$5,100 is pretty high rent. You could rent a Cadillac for quite a while for that kind of money.
That's our business model.
Huh?
That's just our business model. If you compare it to
our...
You
gotta start renting Cadillacs.
I think one thing before we just had the additional detour was $4,000, and I think we're kind of wondering that was one heck of a sign for $4,000, but I see the list of four signs here, which still is expensive, but it's not quite $4,000 for one sign.
Right. After I took the official counts, when we originally talked about it, I didn't have a count on the official number of signs that went out.
Part of the question on the no parking signs, it was 3 weeks into the no parking signs being put up, the city put up no parking signs and asked that these be taken down because of the cost. There was no adjustment. I don't see an adjustment in price for that.
Well, initially we had set out some paper ones that we used for like events. We were out of our standard like the aluminum signs, and we put up these paper ones just to pour some more. And we came up and we swapped those out with actual post mounted no parking, which were left in place then until a couple weeks ago, whatever it was, when the project finished. And them up and took them back over us.
But the city had asked, they said, I think it was 3 weeks into that detour that those no parking signs be, when we saw the price.
I believe what I got back was at the time that would have been an additional mobilization, which we would have had to pay for them to remove the signs.
Okay.
so we didn't want, any additional charges on it. And it would have offset the savings of having the signs removed.
Did we retain our signs?
We did retain our signs. Ours were a little bit larger, and it was easy to identify.
Yeah, I think all of our stuff had sticker on the back with our company name anyway.
I make a motion to approve it.
I'll second.
So we're approving $55,600, correct?
That is the change order on the DOT.
Thank you.
Ertz?
Yes.
Hayward?
Yes.
Hill?
Yes.
Shar?
No.
O'Loughlin?
No.
Hannah?
No.
Vaughn?
No.
We'll have to sit down with the contractor.
Not that we don't want to help them out or something, but it's just, and I know you come to Cal. First of all, that somebody should have done their homework in the first place.
Correct.
But second of all, just a little bit of leeway here. Not that I don't want to work with them, but we have all kinds of old parking signs. This could have been brought to our attention earlier. We could have used ours. Just a little bit of savings here and there, and okay.
Are we looking at some proration on this since they warmed up the duration, or what do people, I mean, do you want to talk to a contractor about what do you want them to do?
I thought it's the contractor eats the bill. We pay the engineers to design this. We're not engineers.
I second that.
I think they should have foreseen it. I think the guy that put signs up, yeah, that's their business. You ought to get paid, but that's Taylor Construction paying them. It's not us saying we're not going to pay him. It's saying we're not going to pay him.
Construction company eat it, or the engineer eat it?
The engineer.
We don't care if you consider it.
Or the, not the guy that put the signs up to separate. I guess they can figure that out themselves, but.
Point is, these were rented signs. That's pretty high price rent. We could have.
I guess it's the engineer, because they're the ones that designed the project and should have foreseen it.
We could have those signs made, and we own them right now for that kind of money.
Well, you're talking about the no parking signs. I agree with you. The four detour signs for Nathan Bethel, I'm not sure that would be the case, but I'm not in the sign business, so I won't argue the price.
Okay.
But the parking signs is the one that was in question.
Yeah, bottom line is the engineering firm should have anticipated the problem.
Yeah, because we knew there had to be a detour. We knew we didn't want the semi-traffic coming through town, particularly on a new road like that. And a winding road, very poor turn radius.
I kind of thought we'd beat that to death beforehand.
I did too. That's why this surprised me.
We did the road the year before that to get prepared for it.
Yeah.
Does that help you all day off?
I think it leaves us in the same place. We'll have to have a conversation with WHKS and Taylor and have a conversation.
Question. Did we ever vote to pay the bills?
Okay. Yes.
I thought this was an exception to that.
This is an exception because it's a change order and the DOT
wasn't included.
I guess while we're still on the bridge discussion, do we have any resolution on what we're doing about the approaches?
We have not I have not received any solutions to that or conversation on that part yet. And I would just take a step back. I don't think this is, I understand the question. I don't think this is a good time for us to have that conversation.
But that conversation needs to take place.
Well, we agree it has to take place. But I haven't had any conversation.
Sure.
In the spring.
again, based on our agenda, I just caution us to, I think we should move on. It's an important topic, but I don't want us to get off topic again at this point. We can talk more in reports.
Next on the agenda is stormwater utility presentation.
Good evening. Hi, Brian. Bear with me for just a minute.
I'm sure you speak into the microphone.
All right. My best. Can I hit it?
Yep.
Shoot it once. Shoot it out.
Can you reach that for you, Dustin?
No, I got it. I can do.
Paul has taped 2 yards fixed together. Us girls can ride with one, but you're gonna need two.
They'll patent that, Jim.
Projector starter.
Depends on how long she will buy it.
It must have gotten burnt a little bit. It must have gotten burnt in his own way.
Good for something. So the Public Works Committee asked me to come in, just have a brief discussion about stormwater. We talk a lot about water, sanitary sewer, and streets, but it seems that we don't always talk a lot about stormwater, and that's becoming more of a popular topic, at least at our committee meetings. So what I want to do is, yes.
I'm going to ask you to speak up just a little bit.
Okay. So what I want to do is, we'll start off with a couple of definitions just so that we're on the same page as we get started. We'll go through some examples here in Independence, both past, and maybe we'll talk about a couple of future needs that have been identified, and give you an introduction to a stormwater utility option. That's a topic that we kind of touched on a couple times at the Public Works Committee, and they decided that it's time to talk about it with the full council. So, definitions here. Stormwater. Pretty straightforward. Water that originates from rainfall events, and we'll add snow and ice melts in there as well. So runoff, it is going to be everything that doesn't soak in. So that's the difference. Everything that doesn't go into the soil is not taken up by plants or held on the surface. And usually, if it's stormwater and it's going into the soil, if it's infiltrating, life is good. Nobody really notices. But when it becomes runoff is when we need to begin to look at how we manage that flow, that runoff.
Does this could happen to Brian Sue's problem or county's problem?
I don't know that it's a problem. It's storage. That's being stored.
Design storage.
So if you, I should have you guys name that place in Independence. So that's just off of the Falcon Civic Center.
It's a county problem that becomes a city problem.
The city causes the partisan problem.
Yeah.
So stormwater management. What exactly is stormwater management? It's really storage. It's about storage and conveyance. We want to consider, when we talk about storage and conveyance, we want to talk about safe conveyance, so that network of inlets and pipes and ditches and on occasion streets that we're sending the stormwater down. It's important to consider volume. That's essential to preventing flooding, erosion, stream channel degradation. All these can cause severe damage that result in high costs on both private and public property. And the other thing with effective stormwater management, we also want to talk about the quality element. So as you know, runoff has a potential to pick up pollutants, chemicals, bacteria, sediment, trash. So not unlike other communities across Iowa, in business is certainly continuing to grow and develop. And so we look at the addition of roads and parking lots, roofs and driveways, compacted lawns as the community develops, and it's a lot less of the infiltration going on and a lot more of the runoff. And if you compile that with the increased rainfall intensities that we've seen here recently.
Where's that last picture at, right?
This one is right across from that entrance of the Falcon Civic Center, so it's...
So the right is where the Creamery built their new building?
Yep, the new building for the Creamery. Just on the right side of the photo there, so that was during construction. So this photo is from a rainfall event in 2018, I think late 2018. This could possibly be that same day. This is out of the South Casey's. These are just some more examples of uncontrolled or unmanaged stormwater runoff.
Did we improve that?
Yes. Good question. We did. You'll see how we improved it in another photo here. I think you guys all know which street this is. This is a frequent flyer when we get these rainfall events. I think we've got photos clear back from 1986 when it's been happening prior to that, certainly. Just another example of some of the businesses.
Did we improve that one?
That are impacted. We did. We did. Actually, Rydell did. And so did Casey's with their underground storm water detention that they did at Casey's as part of that development, and then the stormwater detention pond that Rydell put in there on the west side of their new facility.
So these are all older pictures?
Yes. That one's pretty telling.
Yeah.
There, that picture's worth a thousand words or more. That one really is.
And all of these have been fixed since these pictures were taken?
Well, what I would say is that
the east down the hill from
and the south.
A construction firm.
Yep, and south. To say that they're fixed, I think, would be overstating. We've improved upon it. There's always going to be that event that.
I think what Brian's trying to say with these pictures is every time you put up a building, every time you put in a parking lot, every time you put in a street, the water has to go someplace, and we have a lot more than this. These are just pictures he caught, but if you go down toward the river or down toward Malone Creek, you're going to find a lot of these water backups, people getting water in their basement. So I wouldn't get too focused on whether or not Cy and Charlie still gets flooded. You're just trying to show what water can do.
Yeah, thanks, Bob. Yeah, these are just examples that I wanted to show, like Bob said there. So it's important that we talk about this time of year, as you guys are getting into budget mode after the first of the year. Budgeting for infrastructure needs in our water system, that's a piece of pipe that I know is laying out here in the, as an example, ductile iron pipe that corroded, wore through. In the water department, you've got a usage-based revenue-producing utility there that you can use to budget when these things come up throughout the year. Sanitary sewer, the same thing. It's a usage-based revenue-producing utility. So when these improvements are needed, you've got somewhere to go. You've got a location where you can budget for these improvements so they don't just hit you out of the blue. Roadway, the same thing. You've got the road use tax, and you've got a special assessment tool that you utilize to take care of these needs for streets. But when it comes to storm sewer maintenance, storm sewer issues, you kind of, right now, I think you pretty much go to the street department and ask Tim for help. This is a repair that I'm sure Deb recognizes.
Yeah.
Just northeast of her residence that kind of chased around for a while. Finally had to tear up the street and get in there and remove. I think the debris that's off to the right hand side there is what they found in there that was blocking that was causing the problem. Again, leaning on the street department to take care of the picture there on the left is, you can kind of see. See a photo on the left there. There's a pipe that's collapsed underneath of there. Now the DOT, that was within their right of way, so they picked that one up. This is out at the Enterprise Drive location, so that's just a recent one. And the photo to the right is on 17th Street. Those are the improvements that were made. You can see the larger pipe going in, taking place of that undersized pipe that was causing the back of some of those photos from previous. So other communities in Iowa recognize that stormwater improvements have really been underfunded, and they've developed a user fee to fund stormwater improvement projects within their cities. This is a stormwater utility. I think at least a couple of you have gone to some of the breakout sessions at maybe the League of Cities conference. Heard about these stormwater utilities. So what is a stormwater utility? It's a unit within the city that manages stormwater through the public right-of-way and many times city property. See examples of ponds that are installed, regional detention facilities that cities take over as part of that. It generates revenue solely through a user fee. It is established pretty straightforwardly, really, by a city ordinance. And the fees can only be used for stormwater management activities. That can be written right into your city ordinance. So the goal is to ensure that there's appropriate resources available to manage these the stormwater and stormwater runoff. It includes operation and maintenance, repair and replacement, and it can even involve debt service for flood protection improvements or other larger stormwater infrastructure projects. The question comes up in most communities when they're considering a stormwater utility, why not just pay for it with taxes? And the advocates for a stormwater utility will tell you that property taxes are based on the property value, and property values really aren't proportional to how properties are using the city's storm sewer system. It has to do with the amount of impervious surface on the properties. So value really isn't a factor. In the stormwater utilities, in the stormwater utility, properties pay based on their runoff contribution, and it kind of evens things out. So if you contribute more runoff,
Brian.
Yeah.
In essence, a business like Walmart would pay a huge amount based on your parking lot, roof area, that type of thing, compared to a homeowner.
Yes. The only exception to that would be if Walmart put in a detention facility of their own to deal with their stormwater runoff, then there's room in the ordinance, if you write your ordinance correctly, to issue a credit.
Well, that would like our vote significantly too if they did something like that.
Yes, yeah. Another thing that's unique about stormwater utility, like other usage-based revenue-producing utilities, tax-exempt properties that do generate stormwater runoff, but they don't necessarily contribute to taxes. So you can set it up so that your schools, necessarily advocating for that, but I'll give you a list later of the different communities. communities that have a stormwater utility, some of the statistics where some communities do still exempt schools and churches, but a number of the communities do not. They do send the bill out to those facilities to make it a more equitable system for who's paying for those improvements.
One thing, too, like John was saying before, I can see people dollar signs running through the TV audiences that, oh my God, this can be thousands of dollars of taxes. Generally, it's in the $3 to $5 per roof. Most communities set that. And then the Walmart can figure out what the average roof size is in Independence and decide how many rooftops Walmart's parking lot or building would pertain to. So the average homeowner, we're not talking about even hundreds of dollars, we're talking probably less than $5 initially on this. So just so everybody gets over the mind block of we're talking about huge dollars.
Yeah,
everything great. Starts out small, Bob. Once you get your foot in the door, it's kind of like the nose of the camel in the tent. Once you let the nose of the camel in the tent, pretty soon his head is in there. Next thing you know, you turn around three times and the whole camel's in there. And that's exactly what we're talking about here. We're talking $5 a day, $10 next year. Pretty soon it's up to $1,000.
You know. Is there any regulations on that, though?
There's not a limitation except that you're only able to use the revenue on stormwater projects. You have kind of a self-limiting number there. And the fact is that you're already spending it. Because when we're doing street projects, we're already addressing stormwater issues with that. It's whether or not you want to do it through a stormwater utility or if you want to continue to base it on a property tax valuation when you get to your debt service and whatever. But
we're going to pay either way.
You're paying it either way. It's a matter of creating a dedicated revenue stream that's really focused on making stormwater a priority, which may or may not have been the case historically, but we've seen, and Brian's done a nice job of showing why that should be a priority.
So in the event we have one, when we do the 150 project, if we go curb and gutter for a significant portion of that, this would help defray the costs of the, or this would pay for the stormwater?
Well, theoretically, you would use a portion of the stormwater utility to help address those and make sure that maybe not on the 150 project because there's other funding sources and formulas that have to be calculated.
Sure.
But that begs the question, where does it go off of 150? You still have to move it from 150 to, you know, your stormwater system as you go through there. And that will generate other projects that have to be addressed, currently have to be addressed that aren't. So, I mean, it helps pay for those projects.
One thing we have is, you know, and I think Brian did a good job of, we now know a lot of these things about stormwater runoff, and so we required Rydell's to do something. We required Casey's to do something. We required Wapsie Valley Creamery to do something on that new warehouse as far as water retention so it can slowly seep away. But those are only in the last few years that those things happen. So we've got places in the community where there's not water retention. It looks like a flood coming down the street. The amounts of the rainfalls are getting more than they used to be. They come in torrential downpours now instead of slight drizzles. We've got undersized piping. We've got piping down basically to the west of 150, a lot of that pipe near the river rusted out or broken, and then you start getting the sinkholes. So, you know, we're looking at what we have to work on prior to today, you know, that we've got things we've got to fix. Today we're requiring these things. I think Brian talked about even requiring Rydell's to make their retention pond a little bit bigger to the specs that they hadn't quite met it. 25 years ago, they'd have built that out there and we'd have had a bigger river than Wapsie coming down there.
And we cooperated. We seeded some of the ground too, to make it large enough to viable.
Well, we are working on that, but stuff that was put up 10, 15 years back and farther, runoff was never even considered.
Yeah, that discussion is a really good segue. Bob kind of explained a little bit about the rates and how are the fees determined. You can do a flat rate or what's called an equivalent residential unit. As Bob explained, that is simply a unit of measurement that's based on a typical residential property, and then you can use that figure. It can be factored to allocate fees for non-residential property, those larger, your Walmart properties or your larger properties that have a lot more roof and driveway and porch and patio, more than just the residential units have. But the key is that it's based on the property's relative contribution to stormwater runoff that's going to the city's drainage system. So some example fees for other communities, and Bob kind of alluded to this too, that these are Norwalk's up to 750. This is 2017 data, by the way. But and I do have this is more for future discussion, but I've got a handout here. This was a stormwater utility fee survey, and it's the summary out of that survey. Gives you a lot more detail on what some of the other communities are doing. They've got their population, their annual budget. I don't want to get into the weeds too much on this tonight, but as you guys are going through your budget analysis, I hope to find this useful to at least look at. There's some metrics that you can gauge and look at as you decide whether a stormwater utility is right for it.
I think the real bonus on something like this is we wouldn't be depleting our street funds quite so heavily.
Probably wouldn't have the funding to pay for things, but at least we could put it toward debt service on these projects. And with property taxes not basically about maxed out at where we can at this point in time, and we're using our road use tax. We went to a couple of seminars, and this is being adopted by more and more communities because of the size of the rainfalls, because of the amount of cement and roofs that are put up now that used to take care of used to be grassy areas that took care of that water, and it stood there and seeped in the ground. Now it just takes off.
Could provide that planning element where right now a lot of our stormwater improvements are reactionary. We've got to react to a problem that's just been discovered because of a sinkhole, or because we found out that there's a corrugated metal pipe that leads to the river, the bottom's rusted out. So it provides you an opportunity to kind of plan for some of those things rather than having to react and like we talked about coming out of the street budget. You have intended for improvements in other areas of the infrastructure.
When you look at counties, they're going through this with their floodplains, undersized culverts, and I think we've all take a detour because the culvert washes out, and that's because they're undersized.
Brian, have we done a comprehensive study of the storm sewers in Independence?
We've only done a couple of drainage basins so far. A
couple of the problem ones, right?
Yep, a couple of the problem drainage basins. So no, a comprehensive study of the whole town has not been done. The northwest, the northeast has been studied pretty well. We have looked at some isolated spots on the southeast that some of those photos were showing. And you guys invested in the additional pipe to the increased pipe size to protect those properties out there. So.
Would this make a good project for some engineering student? Hint, to come in and whip up a study of our storm water system?
You bet. Okay. Yeah, you guys have just employed free service of a TEEP study on Highway 150. We're taking advantage of a grant. Nick last month, you guys approved that. So, yeah, if there's other programs out there where you can get Iowa State University or somebody to come in and do some free study work for you, absolutely.
Well, it'd just be nice if we had, you know, let's say 5 years down the road, we have X amount of dollars in this fund if we set it up, and maybe we can do one big project, but four or five little ones along with it to kind of fix up some of the little stuff, and you might not have enough to do two big projects in 1 year, but I think without doing some kind of a comprehensive study, we don't know where all the problems are.
Right, we've got a short list right now,
yeah,
based on immediate needs, but you're absolutely right.
I'm just maybe kind of thinking more long term, I guess.
Part of our problem now is it's kind of, if we don't know, that's best because we don't have the money or we don't want to fix it, so it's kind of don't tell us, and then we don't know we've got a problem until part of the road collapses or a big sinkhole, and then we work with it.
Brian,
any other questions before we move on?
Would this be similar to the environmental impacts fee that we have at the tree dump, where we charge a fee for each residential customer for?
I mean, it's in the same vein as that, or any other user-based fees that the city has for, you know, electric or any of those other ones. It's certainly in the same vein where anyone that has a rooftop here in Independence is contributing to it, unless they have their own on-site retention facility, which maybe there's someone out there. I think more of those on-site retention facilities are unplanned.
Yeah.
But they're there during the right rainfall event. So. All
right. Thank you.
Thanks, Brad.
The one out already,
yeah,
for the first reading.
That's correct. only approve number two and number three on this list.
Which is removing this.
I'll make the motion.
I'll second.
Any discussion? Hamer?
This is just number two and three on this list, right?
Yes.
Hill?
Yes.
Shar?
Yes.
O'Laughlin?
Yes.
Hannah?
Yes.
Vaughn?
Yes.
Kurtz?
Yes.
You have, that is the, you approve the second reading, you have the option to waive the requirements of third reconsiderations. Is that anything we want to address tonight?
No. They put it on the next page.
Okay. And we're going to.
Do we need to hurry up and get these done to get them in the code of ordinances?
We will continue, well, I would suggest we continue to waive our final reading of the code of ordinances until we pass these, because we'll have an extra charge if we add them after the fact.
And that's coming up later in the agenda.
Okay.
For that reason. Okay, the next one is this ordinance pertains to the removal of 2-hour parking limit on Second Street Northeast from the rear entrance of the post office east to Third Avenue Northeast. The library is no longer located on this street, so this is the other one that was the third one before.
This one is a separate one, this is, again, removing the parking limitation on Second, the north side of Second Street.
Bonnie, we can't hear you back here. Maybe your microphone's not on, I don't know. It should make.
I'd make a motion to approve.
Second.
It's pretty much just that yellow strip in front of the old library, isn't it?
Yes.
And the handicap.
And the handicap section, yes.
Doing away.
Well, the handicap is no longer in the ordinance, so that basically is already gone, all you have is the blue paint on the road. This eliminates the 2-hour parking restriction that is currently in the ordinance.
Motion by O'Laughlin, second by.
Kurtz.
I don't hear hands, sorry.
I was O'Laughlin.
Roll call. Shar?
Yes.
O'Laughlin?
Yes.
Hannah?
Yes.
Vaughn?
Yes.
Kurtz?
Yes.
Hayward?
Yes.
Hill?
Yes.
Okay, motion is carried, I won't even ask about the third. Next is the adoption of proposed code ordinances, and we're asking for a motion to table it, to table the third and final reading until after we get some of these other ordinances.
I would so move.
Second.
Motion Hayward, second Kurtz, roll call.
Hannah?
Yes.
Vaughn?
Yes.
Kurtz?
Yes.
Hayward?
Yes.
Hill?
Yes.
Shar?
Yes.
O'Laughlin?
Yes.
Thank you, motion is carried. Next, we need a motion to receive and file proof of publication of notice of public hearing in regards to the SRF planning and design loan for the water system improvements.
So moved.
Second.
By Kurtz, second by Hill, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed the same, motion carried, I need a motion to hold the public hearing.
So moved.
Motion by Shar, second by Hayward, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed the same, motion carried, we are now in public hearing in regards to this ordinance. Was there anybody in the audience that wants to speak on this particular item? Any discussion from council members?
This is basically, we're taking a loan, a zero-interest loan out from the
sewer revenue.
Sewer revenue state fund.
Correct, this is the planning and design loan through SRF, the state revolving loan fund. 0% interest is as we work through the planning and design phase. But we have to have a public hearing in order to enter into a debt instrument, which is borrowing money.
Would this be added to the bond here to be paid off once we do the construction part?
Correct. This is anticipated to be rolled into a larger revolving loan fund, the SRF loan, for construction of this project. This amount gets rolled into that final loan amount once we get to that point. The theory is we don't know what the total construction costs are because we're in the design phase. So they're gracious enough to give us a 0% loan while we go through the year plus year and a half planning process.
Okay, any other questions? Need a motion to close the hearing and receive and file oral and written comments.
So moved.
Motion by Sharp.
Second.
Second by McLaughlin. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, the same. Motion is carried. Moving on to public hearing on proposal to enter into a sewer revenue loan and distribution agreement. I need a motion to receive and file proof of publication of notice of public hearing.
So moved.
Sharp.
Second.
Second by O'Loughlin. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, the same. Motion carried. Motion to hold the public hearing.
So moved. Second.
Motion by Hayward. Second by Sharp. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, the same. Motion carried. We are in public hearing in regards.
Just for, since it is a public hearing, just for the public's, the total on this is $232,000, is that correct?
Between the two, but because one is drinking water, one is clean water, they are two separate funds. That's
right.
Why we're doing them separately. Yes, it's a total of $232,000 planning and design for the total project.
And this is for the planning, like you said, planning and design on 150 reconstruction.
That's correct.
It's coming up. It's a good revenue source for us for zero.
Correct. And it is both north and south. I mean, it's the whole project.
Motion to close the hearing and receive and file oral and written comments.
So moved.
Motion by Sharp.
Second.
Second by O'Loughlin. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, the same. Motion is carried. Moving down to resolution. Motion to approve a resolution taking additional action with respect to the water revenue loan and distribution agreement and authorizing and securing the payment of $131,000 sewer revenue loan and disbursement.
Honey, you skipped.
Yeah.
Or just skipped.
One, two.
Yeah. We're on resolution A.
B. Resolution, take additional action with respect to a sewer revenue loan and disbursement agreement authorizing approving and securing payment of $101,000 sewer revenue loan and distribution agreement anticipating project note. I have a interim loan and distribution agreement.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Kurt, second by Keel. All those in favor, please.
Aye.
Vaughn?
Yes.
Kurtz?
Yes.
Hayward?
Yes.
Hill?
Yes.
Sharp?
Yes.
O'Loughlin?
Yes.
Hannah?
Yes.
Motion carried. Next, I was just reading in one. Resolution taking additional action with respect to a water revenue loan and disbursement agreement and authorizing, approving, and securing the payment of $131,000 sewer revenue loan and disbursement agreement anticipated project.
This would be for the, this is the sewer, or excuse me, no, this is the water revenue. The last one was the sewer.
I'll make the motion.
Motion by Kurtz.
I'll second.
By Hayward. Discussion. Roll call.
Kurtz?
Yes.
Hayward?
Yes.
Hill?
Yes.
Sharp?
Yes.
O'Loughlin?
Yes.
Hannah?
Yes.
Vaughn?
Yes.
Motion is carried. That's from all of that. Next on the agenda is a motion to approve the resolution approving Nate Whited to fill an unexpired term vacancy for 3 years from Chad Beatty's resignation and the Board of Adjustments.
So moved.
Motion by Hayward.
Second.
Second by Kurtz.
Hayward?
Yes.
Hill?
Yes.
Sharp?
Yes.
O'Loughlin?
Yes.
Hannah?
Yes.
Vaughn?
Yes.
Kurtz?
Yes.
Motion carried. Is anybody wondering who won? Yes. Next is a motion to approve a resolution appointing Arlena Schweitzer to a 4-year term on the airport board.
So moved.
Second.
By Hill, second by Kurtz. Roll call, please. Hill?
Yes.
Sharp?
Yes.
O'Loughlin?
Yes.
Hannah?
Yes.
Vaughn?
Yes.
Kurtz?
Yes.
Hammer?
Yes.
Thank you, motion carried. All our committees should be full at this point. Next is on the 2018 assessment interest rate. We approved it, but not for an interest rate in there, so I need a motion to reapprove the 2019 resolution on the 2018 Second Street Northeast PCC paving project to include the amount of percentage assessment interest.
I'll make the motion to put 4% in.
Second.
Motion by Hill, second by Kurtz to make the amount 4%. Roll call, please. Sharp?
Yes.
O'Loughlin?
Yes.
Hannah?
That's what we've been doing for.
Yes.
Yes.
Vaughn?
Yes.
Kurtz?
Yes.
Hayward?
Yes.
Hill?
Yes.
No, they don't have the papers on anymore. Next is the wastewater project closeout.
This is the final of three contracts for the wastewater treatment plant upgrade and renovations that we've done. The engineer is recommending closeout of the project. It is complete. The punch list that was included in his report has also been addressed and completed. So this is about the council taking final action to accept the project as complete and authorizing pay app number 10, 9 and 10 as complete.
Is that the two numbers, the one says 45,970 and one 16,156, are those the two numbers we're putting?
Yes, in the pay app.
In some sense, okay.
I make the motion.
Motion by Kurtz.
Second.
Second by Hayward. Any other discussion? Roll call. O'Loughlin?
I'm sorry, I'm slow on the draw here.
Yeah.
Is this, will we have any retention left?
The 45,000 is the retainage on the project.
Okay, so.
That's that pay app number 10.
So we're saying we're done with everything?
Correct.
Okay.
Now, I believe on this one, we do have to hold that 45,000 for, was it 30 days from your approval? You're authorizing it, you're saying it's complete. We're still required to hold it for a period of time. Number 9, the 16,000 will get paid out, but the retainage we hold for, like I said, it's 30 days.
Everything's going good out there?
Everything's going good. There hasn't been any significant issues that have come up. Now, to be fair, we haven't had that major rain event, which, there have been questions about the pumps at the Lovers Lane lift station and the new flume that they put in at the plant. I don't want to say that we've had a true test on that because we haven't had that major event. But we've got the backup pumps there that are to kick in as well, so we think that is addressing it. And we don't have a mechanism to hold the retainage until we get a really big event, because we don't know when that might be.
O'Loughlin?
Yes.
Hannah?
Yes.
Vaughn?
Yes.
Kurtz?
Yes.
Hayward?
Yes.
Hill?
Yes.
Yes.
Thank you, motion carried. Next is a motion to approve resolution assessing property at 306 8th Avenue Northeast for water service repairs.
I'd make the motion.
Motion by Kurtz.
Second.
Second by O'Loughlin. Any other discussion? Roll call. Hannah?
Yes.
Vaughn?
Yes.
Kurtz?
Yes.
Hayward?
Yes.
Hill?
Yes.
Sharp?
Yes.
O'Loughlin?
Yes.
we do have a dollar amount in your maximum.
There is a not to exceed dollar amount, and Mr. Crawford was also gracious enough to update the agreement to reflect our current risk assessment guidelines through ICAP, so we've got that covered.
Vaughn?
Yes.
Hurt?
Yes.
Hayward?
Yes.
Hill?
Yes.
Sharp?
Yes.
O'Loughlin?
Yes.
Hannah?
Yes.
Thank you, motion carried. Urban renewal. Ordinance providing for the division of taxes levied on table property in the tenant's fifth ward urban renewal area pursuant to section 403.19 of the Code of Iowa. I need a motion to approve the second reading for the ordinance providing for the division.
Is this the set of the LMI area?
Yeah, while it's not an LMI area, it's an urban renewal area for, and in this case, it's a blight area that has been identified. But again, it's the same concept. The urban renewal plan has to have an ordinance establishing this new area. And that's the second reading that you have here. It will require three readings total, like any other ordinance, before we can proceed.
So moved.
Second.
What does the term table property, what does that mean?
It's missing an S. It's taxable.
Oh. Okay, that explains a lot. What was that?
Instead of the word table, it should be taxable.
Oh, okay, taxable. Okay.
I thought it was you owned the properties last on the table. Yes. Okay. Roll call. Kurtz?
Yes.
Sorry, I got a flip. Hayward?
Yes.
Hill?
Yes.
Sharp?
Yes.
O'Loughlin?
Yes.
Hannah?
Yes.
Vaughn?
Yes.
Thank you. Motion is carried.
On this one, I would respectfully request your motion to waive the third reading and proceed with this ordinance so that we can address the development agreement in the next two sections. We do have to have an urban renewal district as established by ordinance before you can approve a development agreement within that district.
We haven't had anybody express qualms on this?
Only Mr. Earl, because he'd like to have this completed.
I would make the motion to waive the third reading.
I'll second that.
Second by Hill. Any discussion? Roll call. Hayward?
Yes.
Hill?
Yes.
Sharp?
Yes.
O'Loughlin?
Yes.
Hannah?
Yes.
Vaughn?
Yes.
Kurt?
Yes.
Thank you. Motion is carried. Next, so we can move on to the next one.
This development agreement has a not to exceed dollar amount of $50,000 for this project, and it is over a 5-year period. Obviously.
And he's using this to build a triplex over in the Presbyterian Church area?
That's correct. It is a triplex rental property. So there'll be three rental units, each has a garage, two bedroom units, varying sizes in that 900 square foot range. It seems like a good project, much better than what was there when it started. And so these are the, you know, again, the development agreement that you're considering has a not to exceed $50,000.
Any other discussion? Roll call, please. Oh, we don't have the motion itself.
Motion to close the hearing.
Close the hearing and receive and file oral and written comments.
Second.
Motion by Loughlin. Did you step first?
Oh, yeah. Hayward.
Motion by Hayward, second by Loughlin. Thank you. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, the same. Motion is carried. Moving on to motion to approve a resolution establishing a development agreement with Longhole, authorizing annual appropriation tax increment payments and pledging certain tax increment revenues to the payment of the agreement.
So moved.
Motion by Kurtz.
Second.
Second by Hayward. Roll call.
Hale?
Yes.
Shire?
Yes.
O'Loughlin?
Yes.
Hannah?
Yes.
Vaughn?
Yes.
Kurtz?
Yes.
Hayward?
Yes.
Now Ron should be happy, right? Got that out of the way?
That's correct.
Okay, moving on to other business, the airport CIP.
This is the draft CIP that is in front of you for your consideration. There are two things that I would like to point out. First is the South Taxiway hangar expansion. If the state DOT wants to fund expanding the apron, if you will, or the taxiway south from where we're currently doing our construction to allow for additional corporate hangars, that is in there showing them that we have a need for that. It's an 85-15 cost share. At this point, it does not, we don't have the money today, but it is simply in our wish list. Likewise, the apron expansion that you see for 2023, this is built into our CIP for a north apron, north of the terminal building for transient aircraft and prop dusting operations that would separate it from our existing tarmac because we have a limited amount of space there. This was put in based on the federal supplemental grant that came out 2 years ago that paid 100% of all costs. Last year, or this 2019, they had their second supplemental grant. It was a 90-10 split, so you'll see a local share in here based on the anticipation that if there's a third supplemental grant, it would be a 90-10 split. Neither of these projects move forward unless there are grant dollars available, but we do have to show them in our CIP if we want to be eligible for that money when it comes around. We cannot put it into our CIP after they roll out the supplemental grant, for example. They want to know what's on our list right now. So these are projects that are out there pending federal or state dollars. They are not priority projects. Our priority project right now is the current tarmac maintenance, which is going to happen in the next cycle. We've got the go letter on that. And then moving forward, we're waiting for our entitlement funds to build back up so we can do our next project. But
I have a question. For the private hangars, that's under construction, that was going south and then going west. Are we jumping over to the south side of the private hangars now and going south?
Well, this would be an extension on the current taxiway that we're extending to the south, which would open up, I believe it's two more hangars, and then we'd have this south taxiway would open an additional three hangars that could open up with that.
So we're moving the southern ones farther south?
Correct.
To add two lots on the east side?
Correct.
Okay. I'm kind of wondering how we were going. We'd have to go right through a hangar and continue south.
No, if we take that taxiway extension that we're, the connector taxiway that we're doing right now, that will allow for at least two more corporate hangars on the east side there. If you look at our airport layout plan, that has a total of six lots along there to address those southernmost corporate hangars. We would have to extend the taxiway south to get them a taxiway.
So I thought we were already finishing the taxiways going south and west. Oh, is that on hold now until this possibly?
No, no, that is under construction. It was supposed to be finished this fall. The weather set in, so they won't finish that until spring now. But that is already funded and in place to go south of the current T hangars. We have one corporate hangar there now. We can, with this project, build two additional corporate hangars.
So we just widen the east-west section of the taxiway?
Correct. Yes.
Okay.
I think the proposed apron that we're talking about on the north end of the airport would be a tremendous advantage if you get that.
Yes, that would be a very helpful project. But again, the only way to reach a project of that magnitude is if we're successful with the supplemental grant.
So does this motion need to be accepting the airport's
accepting the airport board's recommendation to approve the 2019 CIP. We have to submit that later this week to the FAA. This is something we do each year, is approve the CIP to be submitted to the FAA.
I'd make a motion to accept it.
Motion by Kurtz.
Second.
Second by Hayward. Any other discussion? Another roll call. Shar?
Yes.
O'Loughlin?
Yes.
Hannah?
Yes.
Vaughn?
Yes.
Kurtz?
Yes.
Hayward?
Yes.
Hill?
Yes.
Thank you. Motion is carried. Next is discussion on the credit limit increase.
This will be discussed at length at the Committee of the Whole. This represents a compromise in some of the comments and conversation going from our current citywide credit limit of $10,000 to $15,000 without any additional or cards.
I'd make a motion to increase it to 15,000.
I was kind of hoping we'd have had something about regarding card readers on here too. For the
two completely separate topics. One, the card readers is accepting credit card payments. This is not accepting it. This is only our current business card utilization. The challenges we discussed at the Committee of the Whole with the accepting credit payments is our current software, financial software, does not reconcile those payments as they come in. It creates a challenge for us on the back side or the back office area.
I'd second this one.
Motion by Kurtz, second by O'Loughlin. Roll call, please. O'Loughlin?
Yes.
Hannah?
Yes.
Vaughn?
Yes.
Kurtz?
Yes.
Hayward?
No.
Hill?
Yes.
Shar?
Yes.
Thank you. Motion is carried. Okay, next is a motion to approve change order number 4 in the amount of $1,234 for the First Street East project.
This change order covers both the cold weather concrete pour where they had to cover the ground and the concrete, as well as, and probably more importantly, some unsuitable fill that we had to add to the project to keep them on task. We were not able to dry out the soil that came out. We did not want to put that back into the hole after putting in the water lines.
I'll make a motion.
I'll second.
Motion by Hill, second by O'Loughlin. Roll call, please. Hannah?
Yes.
Vaughn?
Yes.
Kurtz?
Yes.
Hayward?
Yes.
Hill?
Yes.
Shar?
Yes.
O'Loughlin?
Yes.
Motion carried. Motion to approve pay estimate number 5 for the Long Creek Bridge project in the amount of $108,531.57.
This is the formal pay request approval that we need for DOT.
Do we have retainage for the railings and the
We do have retainage. retain each this, right.
And on the bill well?
Yes, there is some dirt work or earthwork that has to be done out there, as well as the railing, which if you drove by there today, yeah. The railing is on site, not functional yet, but they did deliver it late this afternoon.
They're working on site.
Yeah, but they've got it setting up there. It'll be up this week. But the retainage is still being withheld.
The bumpiness on the east side, is that, did they ever get back on what they thought?
No.
About doing?
I have not heard anything about the rideability of the project or the additional earthwork. There's some, I'll call it landscaping, for lack of a better term, along the both sides of the trail, as well as the bank itself.
I make a motion to postpone this until we do get.
This is the pay estimate for work that has been completed and is acceptable. This is not that portion that is not.
How do you testify with that?
Well, because they've designated the work that they've done here in the pay request itself.
I could set up a system such as this and say, this is only for what I've done. Even though the cost may exceed $188,000 to appropriately redo it.
I can tell you that this is what the engineer has accepted as work that has been completed and is acceptable to be paid. They understand that we don't accept the ride quality. They also understand the landscaping work that has to be done on either side of the trail. The bridge railing is still outstanding. And we still have retainage for those issues. But
which is what, about $45,000 now?
Right now, the retainage on the pay request here is $27,486.82.
It's enough to cover all that still needs to be done.
I can't speak to what it's going to take to finish that. The retainage is the 3% per contract.
Did you make a motion, Mike?
Here comes Monica. She's an aunt.
Mike, did you make a motion?
To postpone.
You made the motion.
Again, this is just a pay estimate for work that has been completed. There are still a number of issues. This is nowhere near the close of the project. We still have grading issues. We still have seating. We have the railings have not been paid for. It's just a pay estimate to get through the work that has been completed to date as of the end of November, just like all the other pay estimates that have been approved.
What about the rideability on the east side?
That would be a punch order issue that would come up with the punch order and punch list, excuse me, and would be, you would hold the retainage until that's completed to your satisfaction. And the retainage, I think that's just the retainage on this pay estimate. There was retainage on every pay estimate that's been approved. So I'm sure it's... Yes, on $1 million, we're talking $1 million job, it's 10%, 10 or 12%. So you're talking at the end of the project, you know, closer to $100,000 versus just $27,000. And that's still being maintained. Every pay estimate we add to that retainage.
And you've already
correct.
We have a motion.
Oh, Mark,
make
a motion.
Mike made a motion, I think. Did you, Mike?
I'll second to postpone.
I'll second it.
What was your motion?
Initially, until I explain the issues.
Made a motion to postpone payment until the issues were taken care of.
Everybody vote now, and then we'll make another motion.
I think you also I think you also have the option of withdrawing the motion if you wanted to, so you have that option as well.
I'd withdraw the motion to postpone.
So would you like to make the motion to approve the payment of this number 5 or not?
Sorry. No,
I can open it up for anyone else.
That's fine.
I'll make the motion to pay this, or actually we have a retained.
I'll second.
Motion by Bill, second by Kurtz. Further discussion? Roll call.
Vaughn?
No.
Kurtz?
Yes.
Hayward?
Yes.
Hill?
Yes.
Yes.
O'Loughlin?
Yes.
Hannah?
Yes.
Thank you, Mona, for your explanation, Ben.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Oh, my God.
I think it's worth it for that.
It'll take more than that.
Okay, next is the swap agreement.
This is an agreement with the state of Iowa DOT on swap funds to exchange federal transportation dollars for state transportation dollars, totaling roughly $295,000 for our 2020 street improvement project. This matches our $272,000 annual budget for street maintenance. These are the 17 blocks of streets that we have set aside that are on the federal classification for the project.
I would make a motion to accept the swap agreement.
Second.
Motion by Kurtz, second by O'Loughlin. Any other discussion?
Kurtz?
Yes.
Hayward?
Yes.
Hill?
Yes.
Shar?
Yes.
O'Loughlin?
Yes.
Hannah?
Yes.
Vaughn?
Yes.
Thank you. Motion is carried. Been a long night, guys. I did put out for everybody what I helped set up for you for committees. If there's any questions, I'll be on the way, but try to meet everybody's needs that can give me their ideas, what they wanted. As far as seating arrangement, I'll have that before by the first of the year. You'll have fun. And there is a meeting tomorrow night that I want to make sure you all are aware of, or maybe you can, at Hartman and Neighbors, 6 p.m. You want to explain it more?
The folks at Heartland Acres are having a community meeting at 6 o'clock, followed by a board meeting at approximately 7 o'clock. They are proposing some pretty significant changes out there. They would like to have the council come out and hear what they're doing and what they're proposing. And again, that's tomorrow night at 6 o'clock at Hartman Acres.
Okay. And I also then would like to thank Danny for his service, since this is your last meeting.
Right.
And we're going to let you move when we're ready to turn to make the motion.
Motion to adjourn? Are you ready?
Not yet.
I was ready to go home.
We'll wake you up on this.
I'm sure we'll still see you. You'll just be in a different chair, because I can't imagine your vehicle won't just automatically come across when it's nights and such.
Imagination's running away with
me. You'll miss us. Well, thank you for your service, for all your years that you've provided for the community. Do you have anybody else, council, have anything else they want to share?
Can you briefly tell us when the meetings are on this? Public safety is on Monday or Tuesday.
One thing that we'll do is, once the new committees are set, we want to double check to make sure that the times all fit. But where we're meeting right now is Government Performance Finance is on Monday mornings at 8 or 10, depending on when the committee can make it. It's been 10 most recently. Monday at 2 o'clock is Public Works. Tuesday at 3:30 is Public Safety.
Some of those may have changed, just to make sure everybody has been put on those committees now and still meet the time. So the three people that's on the committee will have to make sure they arrange what works out for everybody.
And how about the senior center? Do you know about that?
I should have that, but I'll let you know.
Okay.
I think it's either the second or third Thursday.
I would do a library.
anything on my agenda.
You thought there was a meeting for a while and you thought so? Who called the meeting?
I'll have to go back through that, Deb, I don't have anything on my.
Todd shares.
Yeah, I'll have to double check with Todd, but I don't have anything right now.
Anything else to share?
I have a couple of items, I wanted to give you an update on our recycling discussion. Talking about how we can reopen the cardboard recycling for city residents. I've talked with Waste Management on a couple of occasions, and I think that we have a working agreement in principle. There's some facts and figures that have to be put together before I can bring you something to respond to. So I'm cautiously optimistic that we're heading in the right direction, but there will be some money involved, and what that looks like, I want to find out before I bring that back. But everybody's very open to it, and I was impressed with the receptive nature of both town and the folks at Waste Management. Bridge railing, I just wanted to point out what's going in this week, and so you should see that take place. And on January 6th, we will do photos before our work session. We have a new council person, so we want to make sure we get a council group photo and individual photo for a new council member for the website. And Mary Ann is coming on January 6th from the state library director's staff to discuss library operations, authority, etc. It is a follow-up presentation from the one that was done November 23rd, I believe it was.
What's the date for that presentation?
January 6th.
It's in our work session.
So if we've already been to it, we can't go through it again. The opportunity is there.
You have the opportunity.
And you'll get paid for this one.
You don't want to miss this one. You need to get paid for the last one.
Don't tell him that.
It might be worth sitting through it a second time. You know,
I did request that Laura invite the library board to come in and sit with us on this one so that there's an opportunity for the city council and the library board to have a conversation afterwards. I think the value in it, more than the presentation, is the opportunity for the two bodies to sit down and have a conversation.
I'll do it by phone now, but I won't be here for the picture.
You what?
I'll be here for the picture.
Why won't you be here for the picture?
No, I don't think I'm going to come back from Texas to get my picture.
Oh.
Can we drop it in? Get a, well, I didn't must make a cardboard cutout for you.
Photoshop.
I got it.
Somebody out there.
Did you get the picture? We'll just put
you
it
got
in.
It. We'll crop it down.
Yeah. You can turn it back.
Are you saying fake news here on this council?
Fake picture.
So we'll let him come. And he can be holding your picture up in front of
you.
Will that work?
So our next meeting, or our next get-together will be January 6th?
The next scheduled the gathering of the council is January 6th at 6:30.
Yep.
Or if we can be here a few minutes early to do the
picture.
If you've got a photograph, an individual photograph, you want a new one, we'll take care of that at the same time. It's hard to improve on perfection.
So then our next regular meeting, on the 13th of January?
January 13th is the council meeting.
Anything else?
That's all I have.
Merry Christmas, everybody.
Can I have a motion for an adjournment?
Let's go home.
Second.